So the next item of business is a debate on motion 14484 in the name of Kate Forbes on Scottish Languages Bill at Stage 1. I invite members who wish to take part in the debate to press their request to speak buttons. And can I just suggest to all members that they are on Channel 2 to hear the interpretation. Channel 2. And members who are remote will have received an email with instructions. And I now call on Kate Forbes, Cabinet Secretary, to speak to and move the motion. Up to 10 minutes, please.
Offergar really. Hame a cur falche eir a chorum gus in jespidsio osglug a huv a glosid taich a chur re principle in farsing bille nan canon alabanach. De voren chanye giroch cúsh fobloch a haun in canon ach ni a hae cria na coirsnoch gachga agus hasin fir yonse. Erskashin, she urim a haun yaw a vi a fosglug in jespidsio. Bemalum tang a horsto chimitian erlum son maravyachgach iet an un doi hugshoch, heichel hushaw. Mohan kuchoch do chimiti in kuochgen chimichche agus a lesichi nil in lugge, agus chimiti in inavish agus ne rianach popolich son in kuch yawlis is brechnachach achge. Hami kuchoch gumor in common nin dunye, a kurshachet unye gas fienish. A horst shachet. Of a good really, it of his show, ha common Gaelic, a vein lessehi Gaelic, a corruch, in da ichitiv kyan blina ache. Nur chai common Gaelic, a stierch, noch jichel and palches, vo a mess koirschnochgen na Gaelic. Sam mar horrig ne reinig eet, a nurschen, a hanik pischach ne servischen, a vadum furchen, de koirschnochgen Gaelic. Merischenpler, ha said of ish cruelly na Gaelic aking, ha furlum thravia na Gaelic aking, yelling agus fulshachuch na Gaelic. Ha na roinan shin a chur ri ar behe cultural, agus hir a vui achga gu ether nashanta, le imuch buil is buonach a chin vo inyaloch na Gael. Femishin kainachuch irin fiagin a chur na projectin shaw ir kosh, gan chikiv reinat jiffer, Chai urtis a yanu agus huk in realtis taich shachet. Hashin haast a kurish in jilib shin. Of a gurili, as jay sheachach parliament na halapa, chunachis chiluch et tuluch impi is urtis. Va koyrshnachgen a giri inive hirinche agus in kyaun unye chud a parliament sho unte ri ach na Gaelic. Hai barsh na Gaelic as sheachach. Julich uderis in poblach planich in Gaelic, agus hosich seinich in Gaelic, in nochge gyr priaf rajin agus toklichin. Chai shanel Gaelic is stiachach an a davilis a hoch, va davilis a shia hosich ich skolchin Gaelic fa le is stiachach. Va na hirtisin a hanig va koirsnach gyn a Gaelic kutramach. Kutchich va farnam a chain kutramach de hordin a lesachin sio, agus va in taich a chur a chula party rishachanin na chuchachach mor. Rein na rutinshin ule jifir. Get the ha urtis aun, ha fiskevel dul in roin hast. Ha tulluch urtis a yi sna skolchin, an un skirin le ganyad slui, agus huv na dulin economicach is buntructor. She an opera ha roin arichin suspenchach, a churin sas is jay blianichin, jay villig agus krianuch. Chanyel sheen gar mielach hain a huv na vias a yi. Chanyel sklio ar lersin nur a heke gu fyrin in suyachuch, agus chanyel sheen son gen len kushin jiroch mara haet. Bemalum fachgul nyo ga ara ma alabish inish. Shachgan chai chai duishin na halabish a chumul an an kumnach an an shirach eir an eir. Ma verish sul an a shorshichin duishin na dunya a chai a voluch agus an luch taike hai a torsht mishnach gein. Hai a torsht jalav e roin na halabish a has lan spinae is gniev agus a sirvachach faravel dunya va roinchin leach fulam fulshachach agus na helain eir an ruchgachach. Ha jifre vuinen e gianu upper inivolte, aun a vi a kut taich ri alabish. Har nam blianichin, meirig ha realtis halpe taich a horse del vuinen, leach in Scots Language Centre, Scots Hoos, dictionaries of the Scots language, Doric radio, agus gan cúrsa ag an olhai oscailte agus fhoirlim alapa a ha cúitichach hítirin le bhí ag gionsachach alabish. Seo chiad turis a ha alabish ir a bhí mar fars de rúchsachs sa fhoirlimit seo. Leisin ha sin a tócal ir upar nan buianin alabish agus ir sirvachas nan scrífadarin, Seinadarin agus teacherin alabish, a bhel fianis gulior ag duasin na halabish. Of gurili, has she na tors bile nan canin alabinach irrst. Gastructurin is sheachuch, son baroch urtis ianu. Leshin tuxe, nach tor en bile hein, frikersgein, son gach keist. Bien bile, a cur taich gri immerstin, a hagen curin sas ek ira in realtis, nan uteris in publoch agus na coirsnach. A fe mora ule, agus gutrich hek urtis mar horig, coirsnach gen is uteris in a vee goper kolig, gestructurin kutrimach a chur irvaun, a veer corum do gunye na himmerstin shaw a curin sas. A huv immerstin stichtje is ur, ha eishin plurin gulioraking, leid som rostig, a corich in le hiatav cam bliana achga in uri. Agus in ursin, has in a geno fewer, ri tokloch ur, chnoch salier, a vi jesil an avliana an an uist a jes. But malam tying a horse yan chimiti, har a cur falche ir grun fengen an an ashk na chimiti, mar a hait a brain ir eging in suyachug, agus ir mar a yemer baroch a yanu. Cúteach bheith cimití ceirst an a bhí a chur cúteam ar compáirst na coirsneachgan, taich de fhoirlim tar bhí na Gaelic, dhúnsachach tuamh mí na scoile, fhoirlim Gaelic uirteach agus ard ire, teacher in Gaelic, phríomhachasin is fhoirlim alabais. Bí ag údaris an inadal ag a bhfuil fhoirlim tar bhí na Gaelic is planach in Gaelic, rí planach in colony uolchach ar son fhoirlim Gaelic. Gekutrimach, stéchich in bile freim, geskieren kanen sonrietje e korachach, agus sean na vien kuadach, gus dlestenis ure e chud, buienin poploch, son na vien njörstachach kor e kanen. Ha fysakim gevel kutjaun a ha granachel in bile lager gilior, ha meir kanyachach ri bai farlamage van a party in ele, gus djervachach gevel mi djonach oprachach kolerue, aarichen ek ire ega. Gujerev, han realtis in duel aarichen ek hurirurst, gus lietachach, na korichen is korumen, a vias ek dunye, a ha furach, an un skieren, kaning, soriche. Hami guhare biachachach, roinenin a huv mar a judach barach parch, a vie koyersnachken, an a vie a korachach, skieren, kaning, soriche. Bemalum, offiger in lessichi Gaelic eiching, ans gach skire can and sorice, eg vig a goper gus taike kummel, ri koyersnochen an an imigdoi, gus ardachach a horst, arvin luchlaversne Gaelic, agus gus servischen ure, ekurir doi, jan chuladunye, etter a chaun, es oike, agus na dunye a shinye. Hemi kutjach a biachachir, mar a gos kor a stiechach, son skulchen Gaelic falle. Agus in bí cór imirach a bhí sin am sa bhile. Se hiad chórara a bhíos aking sarvachach, ma bhíos córam e cúchigin a ha fílinta an na Gaelic an draste, a bheith fat achge a cúrsache tra bhíon in na Gaelic, sin scíra in na dalachge. In dárna córa, ma bhíos sin ag aon e ná chúnta slúi, stat a chúr a chríanúig a chaer tín arvan luchlavers na Gaelic sin a skíran traditionta. Ní helanin an ír in chelan skíanach agus coirsnach gan ile sin a helanin agus a chosta. Of a gurili ha tór in bíle hén fúasgloch gain son a chulurut. Ach, Ver is stuurig gaan opper in die buienen poppelig na halpe, de ruilum is jongsigig na galik is na halpes, agus de roper is immerstin koiersnog. Of ik gerielie hami a kurfaaltje in een taik a chuur in bille huke sjo. Hami a koierter urs rivi a kleintjen biachken dunje, agus bemalen mollig dan a beil taik a chuur rivi principalen farsing bille nen kanen alabenog. Tap live.
Thank you. And I now call on Sue Webber on behalf of the Education, Children and Young People Committee. Up to 9 minutes, Ms. Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. For the avoidance of doubt, I'll be speaking in English this afternoon, so you don't need your headsets. I am delighted to be speaking today on behalf of the Education, Children and Young People Committee, and I'd like to thank my colleagues for their diligent work on this bill so far, and all the people and organisations who provided evidence, either in person or by responding to our call for views. And we're also grateful for the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee and the Finance and Public Administration Committee for their work scrutinising this bill and for sharing their conclusions and recommendations so timely so that we could reflect on them when considering our report. And as our report makes clear, the committee does support the general principles of the bill, namely to provide further support for Scotland's Indigenous languages, Gaelic and Scots. This is me using, however, we believe the bill will have limited effects in its current form. While stakeholders told us of the symbolic value of declaring these languages official, particularly in relation to Scots, witnesses also highlighted the long-standing challenges around the funding for Scots and Gaelic. Many cited Bord na Gaeilge's budget as an example. Its budget has remained largely stable for the last 17 years, rising from £4.4 million in 2006-2007 to £5.1 million in 2024-25, and had it kept pace with inflation, its annual budget would now be in and around £7.5 million. The Board stated that as a result, it is constrained in the support that it can give to the community and other projects, and in its last funding cycle, for example, it could only fund or part fund 39% of the projects who applied. Witnesses stated that without more resources, the aspiration of the bill would be undermined, and the limiting costings set out in the financial memorandum did nothing to allay these concerns. Sorry, guys. Symbolism on its own will not be sufficient to address the challenges, particularly for Gaelic, which is in a perilous position. It requires support to ensure that there is an increase in both the number of speakers and the fluency of their language skills. And on the point of fluency, the committee noted the evidence highlighted the desire for speakers to have more functional fluency in Gaelic as an outcome of Gaelic Medium Education, or GME, as we'll probably hear it referred to throughout the afternoon. And that is that speakers should be able to use the language in everyday situations. So the committee recommended that the Scottish Government include this as one of their identifiable outcomes within the strategy and to develop a consistent national measure for this. The committee was also struck by the repeated requests from organisations and individuals alike for much more clarity in the bill, whether that was in relation to what the strategies, standards and guidance which will be pursuant to the bill will contain, their associated costs, or indeed what an area of linguistic significance might look like within local authorities where there are proportionately fewer Gaelic speakers. There are many questions still to be answered. And the committee therefore notes that the response from the Scottish Government did include illustrative examples of the kind of measures that could be included in the standards and guidance. And these were helpful and encompassed a wide range of areas, including publications, community development, online materials and impact assessments. And in relation to education, areas covered included GME access, provision, teacher requirements and catchment. And I noticed the Deputy First Minister made relevant reference to some of the GME provisions in her opening remarks. Many highlighted the potential for the bill to provide more coherent policy in support of both languages and associated dialects, with national strategies being authored by the Scottish Government. And while education is critical, it is hoped that such coherence will ensure that areas such as housing, infrastructure and economic policy are also considered when taking steps to support communities. Such steps, which could in turn support these languages to thrive. In its response to our Stage 1 report, the Scottish Government has said that it is keen to explore the extent to which infrastructural issues can be included in standards and strategy, and the committee does look forward to hearing more about the potential for these to feature in the Gaelic language plans in the areas of linguistic significance. I will try, yes.
Deputy First
Minister. Just to take on the record the member's willingness for the committee to engage with myself at stage two to try and put into effect some of the committee's criticisms, which I would be keen to do.
I thank the Deputy First Minister's response there, and I think, yes, having with a change in leadership in terms of who's responsible for the bill over that time will hopefully help us work together more closely over stage two-ish. Okay, thank you very much. We've also highlighted concerns from stakeholders that the consultation required on the draft strategy would potentially be limited and that the results of the consultation should be published. And I know we've had some clarification from the Scottish Government that will ensure full public consultation on the strategy. And whilst recognising the Scottish Government's assurances that this was always the intention, we do welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to consider what further measures can be taken to ensure that this is clearer and on the face of the bill. The Scottish Government's response to our report set out that it had recently been standard practice, in fact, for the Scottish Government policy documents on Gaelic to be issued for public consultation and for these to be accompanied by public meetings, meetings with a range of community and interest groups, as well as ministerial meetings, and that following this process, an independent analysis is prepared from Scottish ministers and the results of consultation and the analysis published. So the committee does welcome that reassurance, and if that is how the consultation on the national strategy is going to be treated, we welcome that as well. In terms of Scots, the committee acknowledges that almost half of the population reports to having some Scots language skills. However, the formality of the infrastructure for Scots is much less advanced and compared to that for Gaelic. And the committee heard evidence that declaring official status for Scots was a mammoth step forward and important in and of itself. However, more support and resource was required. For instance, in its report, this committee noted that in the absence of a Scots language board, and we're not saying there needs to be a Scots language board, the Scottish Government is relying on Scots organisations to engage on the Scots strategy, standards and guidance. And the committee further noted that given resource constraints, these organisations may not have the capacity to engage in these processes without actually affecting their day-to-day activities. Let's see, where am I? These are small organisations, and we heard that responding to multiple consultations, for example, on standards and guidance, is resource-heavy and intense. Although the organisations stressed the need for more resource, both Scots and Gaelic organisations, they are concerned that, from the costings in the financial memorandum, any increase in resource for Scots would be at the expense of Gaelic. And the committee welcomes the Scottish Government commitment in its response to reflect on measures that could be considered in relation to this. The committee also welcomes the Scottish Government's commitment to try and reduce the burden on Scots organisations by considering, where possible, if it can consolidate consultations. And the committee also heard concerns that the current definition of Scots within the bill lacks the nuance required to encompass the various regional variations. And the committee believes that the purpose of official status is to give recognition to Scots in all its forms. It must be more explicit. Must be a much more explicit reference to all of those forms, and the bill should set out that much more clearly. The committee notes that the Scottish Government's response that it took its lead from the Speaker community for Scots as the overall and umbrella term within which all forms and regional varieties are recognised and respected. And I would stress, however, that many stakeholders who provided evidence to the committee did not consider the bill to be sufficiently clear regarding its intended inclusiveness. And I reiterate that the Education, Children and Young People Committee supports the general principles of the bill. However, much more clarity is required on how the provisions in the bill will be used and how they will be supplemented by other policy and budgetary decisions to achieve the aims of the bill. I'm pleased the Deputy First Minister shared additional information ahead of the debate today. As we made clear in our report, we expect more detail, more clarity, as well as further costings prior to stage two proceedings. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and I now call on Liam Kerr. Up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. At stage one, this Parliament considers a narrow point on whether to vote for or against the principles of a bill. It does so following consideration by, in this case, the Education Committee, which has produced what is, in my view, a very fair report, which rightly flags a number of challenges. for which the witnesses who helped us, the clerks to the committee and indeed my fellow members deserve great credit. The Scottish Languages Bill expresses its general principles as to provide further support for Scotland's Indigenous languages, Gaelic and Scots. And on that narrow basis, I can confirm the Scottish Conservatives will vote for the general principles of this bill at decision time tonight, in order that it can move to stage two, the amending stage, where I think radical surgery is required. Let me explain. There was a report last week about the SNP's repeated failures in government to deliver the intended outcomes of their stated policies alongside a failure to evaluate their effectiveness. And I fear that this bill may result in more of the same. Witnesses told us as much. The Bord na Gaeilge said, the legislation will not solve the issues that we face at community development level, which requires a new and transparent investment model that can deliver the targets in a new National Gaelic Language Plan. Professor O'Gilligan said the bill would not introduce anything new that will help the vernacular community in the islands with the linguistic crisis that they live with. Indeed, we heard and have just heard the bill described as of symbolic importance only, which is hardly what the Gaelic community in particular would be hoping for. And throughout the evidence taking, there was persuasive and indeed pervasive indications that much, if not all, of what's in this bill could perhaps more competently and coherently be achieved through non-legislative means. You see, Presiding Officer, I think this bill suffers by seeking to address two issues which are at very different stages and require very different interventions. Gaelic is evidentially, clearly identifiable and definable as a language, and it seems to me perfectly possible, and indeed way past time, for the government to decide what it wants to achieve in relation to Gaelic, where the 2005 Act has fallen short and why, what the outcomes and measures of success might be, and therefore what is required, and at what cost to achieve them. The Cabinet Secretary aspires to reversing the tide, but I don't think that's really a measurable outcome on its own. And I do think it regrettable that those are not currently in this bill, but hopefully those deficiencies at Part 1 can be rectified at Part 2. But Part 2 of the bill seeks to do things around, as Section 26 puts it, the Scots language. And this is where, following this debate, I wonder if the government may feel it prudent to reflect carefully on what it's trying to achieve in this part and whether this bill's best place to do it. Because the problems start immediately with the Law Society's submission recognising, as the committee did, that if the bill persists in defining the Scots language as the Scots language as used in Scotland, apart from being circular, it's simply a prescription for ambiguity and uncertainty. Because recognising Scots without defining what falls within that and what falls without that, all that will be achieved is simply to fold all of Scotland's dialects under a term recognisable by those in parts of the Central Belt, but utterly alien to those speaking the Doric, for example. Yes, I will.
John Mason.
Yeah, I thank the member for giving way. Would he not accept that at least this is a step in the right direction? And he might want to go further, or he might want to do it differently, but by having Scots in statute, that does make a pretty big difference.
Yes. Tim Kerr.
No, I don't accept that. This is a step in the right direction, but not if you're going to homogenise everything under one term that is indivisible. And that is the point the committee made, that's the point the witnesses made, and that is the point I'm making, John Mason, that you cannot simply deem everything Scots and thereby make something like Doric unrecognisable. To jump ahead briefly for clarity on that, when teachers and authorities are performing their new duties under Section 31, which are to promote, facilitate and support Scots language education, they might very well ask, what is the Scots they are promoting? Is it Lallans? Is it the Doric? Is it Orcadian? And James Wiley of Orkney Islands Council actually told the committee that Orcadian and Shetlandic are not Scots dialect. They are separate language. But that is not recognised if they're grouped under this term Scots. And that ambiguity is replicated by the conveying of official status on Gaelic and Scots by Sections 1 and 26 respectively. Nowhere is it defined what official status actually means. Now, members may feel that this lack of clarity is not so important, But the committee found itself very concerned as to what obligations the strategies, standards and guidance which will be developed pursuant to this bill will place on public bodies, because that is not clear, nor are the associated costs. You see, Presiding Officer, the financial memorandum in this case sets out additional costs arising from the bill. That's the whole bill for Gaelic and Scots, remember, at £700,000 over 5 years. Now, what is apparent is that this is an estimate of cost to develop the strategies and the like, in other words, additional cost for existing people. What it is not is the cost of delivering those strategies or the extra duties imposed when one designates an area of linguistic significance. Now, in Ireland, additional resources are put in place to ensure better support for the use of Irish and Gael tax areas. In contrast, this bill doesn't anticipate any additional spend in designating such an area, which is bizarre, because given the committee found that some of the activities which would take place in an ALS are already there and it's not clear that legislation is required, and stakeholders are unclear as to what an ALS practically means, what it will look like or the duties imposed, if it is accepted, as I think it was by the Cabinet Secretary in her remarks, that once a local authority has designated an ALS, it creates additional duties, then without commensurate additional funding for tools, mechanisms or employees, our cash-strapped local councils may be reluctant to so designate. Now, the committee has asked the Scottish Government to revisit the costs set out in the financial memorandum and provide further detail on the full financial costs associated with the bill's provisions prior to stage two. I personally find this and the idea that new and significant duties are brought in at stage two a pretty unsatisfactory way of making law, but we are where we are, and it's to be hoped that the government will comply. Presiding Officer, I conclude where I started. The principles of this bill are so general that people really couldn't argue with them. But they do argue that it is symbolic and won't ultimately achieve its aims, its laudable aims, even if it doesn't actually do much damage either. And I certainly believe that it is preferable that this Parliament should legislate for outcomes rather than optics. Which leads to my final thought. A significant number of people have asked me, given the attainment gap is widening, given free meals for primary kids have gone the way of laptops and pushbikes, given violence is endemic in our schools, teacher numbers are plummeting, and child poverty remains where it was in 2007, whether Part 2, especially, of the Scottish Languages Bill represents the best use of the limited, perhaps very limited, time left in this session. And I wonder if, in closing, the Deputy First Minister might give them an answer. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Michael Mara. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Nearly 20 years after the first Gaelic Language Act, this bill comes at what is a critical point for Scotland's ancient language and culture. In the words of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in its Stage 1 report, the Gaelic language is in a perilous state. Other speakers have covered the Scots language provisions in the bill, and the Deputy First Minister, I thought, set out well some of the institutional progress around that area. But I'm going to concentrate my remarks today on Gaelic, as I believe the very survival of the language is at stake. Research by academics at the University of the Highlands and Islands, published in 2020, revealed the depth of the Gaelic crisis in the vernacular community. The decline in Gaelic speakers is steepest amongst young people, the majority of whom were not using Gaelic socially or in the home. And the evidence is clear. Without changes to policy and intervention at community level, the present Gaelic vernacular community will not survive beyond the next decade. The social use of Gaelic within these communities is at the point of collapse. A plan is required to revive Gaelic that is rooted in the communities where the language is spoken. These experts are clear, and I quote, "The education system alone cannot effectively implement revitalisation efforts among the Gaelic vernacular community." And yet here we are. That is exactly what we have received to date. A gnarly drawn and poorly conceived piece of education legislation. Recent census figures should not be used by this government to mask the imminent demise of a living language. It is at best statistical sophistry to equate Gaelic speakers of limited proficiency in the Central Belt with a living language in the vernacular community. And I know that the Deputy First Minister did not seek to do so in her own speech, but it has been used in other circumstances. These young people leave school and never speak Gaelic again. Young people in the islands leave home and never live in a Gaelic community again. And so dies this ancient culture, preserved only as an academic curiosity. The issues that endanger Gaelic are principally economic and social. And last October, Scottish Labour published a policy paper entitled An Economic Plan for a Living Language, which argued that economic issues, including housing, jobs and other critical infrastructure, must be addressed in order to arrest the decline in the Gaelic language. The Deputy First Minister, I suspect, agrees. The report of the Short Life Working Group on Economic and Social Opportunities for Gaelic rightly acknowledged the structural issues that must be addressed. More than a year after publication, though, the Scottish Government has made no formal response. I would urge the Deputy First Minister, who in her previous role in government commissioned that report, to see that response published as soon as possible. The bill in front of us is far too narrow, and alone it will not meet all of our shared objectives. The Deputy First Minister might also look to the proposed crofting bill, which has been fairly universally slated. It's described by the Scottish Crofting Federation as extremely disappointing. Continued decline of crofting tenure will do more to harm Gaelic than any good that might come from this bill. And the bill does give responsibility for a national Gaelic strategy to the Scottish Government, replacing the previously responsibility for a national Gaelic language plan which sat with Borna Gaelic. The Board have welcomed that clarity and the change that that will bring. On areas of linguistic significance already covered in the contributions, a range of stakeholders told the committee that further clarity is needed, and I was glad to hear the Deputy First Minister recognise that significant changes are required in this regard. Because as it stands, it remains unclear how such a designation would work in practice or what further duties would be placed on a local authority. Given that there is zero financial resource, pointed out by colleagues already attached to the bill, local authorities may be reluctant to designate an area of linguistic significance, or the designation may exist in name only. Stakeholders have already suggested that we could even end up in the perverse situation where an authority with a clear and compelling case for designation of linguistic significance chooses not to, simply because they are already vastly overburdened and see the prospect of extra duties with no additional resource. The bill inserts a new Section 6B into the Education Act 2016, giving Scottish ministers power to make regulations to prescribe the standards and requirements of an education authority in relation to Gaelic learner education, Gaelic medium education and the teaching of Gaelic and further education. However, as the committee heard in evidence, the biggest issues rest in teacher recruitment and retention for Gaelic medium education, and there has been no indication from the government that they have further interventions planned to address those issues. I fear that this legislation is raising expectations around GME without any of the necessary resource or action to be able to deliver on those expectations. Furthermore, having spoken with leaders in education, I know there is real scepticism about the extent to which any of this will be achieved without additional resource. They are weary of government promises in education policy and press releases hailing consultations and reviews which fail to deliver any of the tangible actions needed. The Muir Review, the Hayward Review, the Withers Review, the Reform of Education Scotland, the abolition of the SQA. Nothing ever happens. Nothing happens at all. And were there a financial resolution today, given all I've said so far, we would be it was citing the £0 and zero pence cost of expanding duties, then Labour would have rejected it as incompetent. Exactly 2 weeks ago, we were in the Chamber for the Finance Secretary's now annual statement of in-year budget crisis cuts. And I am acutely aware of the pressures on the budget stemming from an incompetent SNP government that has made promises it cannot afford to keep. However, it's not credible to keep increasing the duties on public bodies and yet claim that that costs nothing. And the Finance and Public Administration Committee, of which I am a member, was very clear in that regard. During her time as Finance Secretary, the Deputy First Minister was keen to align her government's promises with fiscal realities. She is, I am sure, painfully aware the current Finance Secretary and indeed the First Minister have taken a rather different approach. If she cannot win the argument for fiscal responsibility around the Cabinet table, at least in the bills in her control, the Deputy First Minister should do so. So Scottish Labour does support the general principles of this bill, but bluntly, the best that can be said at present is that if amended, it will do no harm. Scottish Labour wants to make legislation that does some good. We have waited 20 years for legislation on Gaelic. On the current course, in another 20 years' time, there will be no language to save.
Thank you. I now call Ross Greer, around 6 minutes. Mr Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to the clerks for fixing my pass, and apologies to colleagues on the Labour benches who were getting distracted potentially by my doing laps around their desks. I think we all agree on the principle of valuing the Gaelic language. As we've heard from Liam Kerr, there's perhaps a bit more difference when it comes to how we approach Scots in this bill. But just starting with Scots before moving on to most of my contribution on Gaelic, I do think symbolic recognition is important. In this case, symbolic recognition of a language that's not had that before in law is important. Scots is a language that's undergone centuries of denigration. It's a living language, as the census showed us. It's thriving in all sorts of ways that Gaelic isn't, despite sustained efforts to force it out of public life. But on Gaelic, we've waited 20 years for this bill, and I think it's fair to say that the response to it has been underwhelming. It won't be transformational when transformation is what's needed, and I fear that the bill as it's currently drafted is the result of that classic political process: we needed to do something, so we've done something. The census showed two very different stories in relation to Gaelic, as has been indicated already. The number of Gaelic learners is growing, but in traditional communities, where it is a living community language, it's in steep decline. We've got the story of Gaelic medium education schools in the Central Belt and Duolingo learners, which is both very positive developments. But the reality for a young person who goes to GME school in Glasgow is they can't go into a shop on the way home or into a cafe and order or buy something in Gaelic. It's not a language that they can live their life in. We've seen some progress in extracurricular activities, sports clubs, community groups, but it's not a community language. And in the communities where it is, it's under existential threat. And we heard, I think, a really good anecdote of evidence of what it actually looks like to have a living community language. And it was one of the witnesses who came to the committee at stage one saying that she saw in Lewis a group of boys, teenage boys, who were misbehaving on the street in Gaelic. That being an example of what it's actually like as a living language. And again, I don't want to dismiss the value of symbolism here, especially when the legitimacy of Gaelic and Scots has been challenged for centuries and is still in many ways challenged today. The Scottish Government and Parliament making a clear statement in law has value, but on its own I don't think it's good enough. This bill will pass, there's no reason for it not to, but it is currently a missed opportunity. So the question for this afternoon is, can we amend it at stages 2 and 3 to mean something much more? I want to run through a couple of the amendments that the Greens are considering bringing forward at stage 2. And the first is about measuring success. I think it's good for responsibility for the National Gaelic Language Strategy to sit with Scottish ministers. But there's not much value in a strategy that's all motherhood and apple pie. If the strategy is that we are going to make things better, we will probably all be back here in 5 or 10 years, or our successors will be very disappointed by the fact that things did not get better. We need to be much clearer about what we mean and how we actually measure success. So the Greens would like to consider an amendment that would require ministers to outline how they will measure success, how they will measure progress towards the goals set out in any strategy. And success looks different in different places. You know, if we want to move beyond Gaelic as a language only spoken in GME schools in places like Glasgow and Edinburgh, we would do that in a very different way to how we protect it as an existing but declining community language in Lewis.
Yes. Harper.
Thank you, Ross Greer, for giving way. So I'm thinking about what you're saying about measuring success. And one of the things that I think might be a useful thing is that the census used to say, do you speak Scots? But now it says, do you read, write and understand and speak Scots? So would you think that that would be something that we could use as a measurement of success?
Ross Greer.
I'm grateful to Emma Harper for that intervention, because I think that the value of the census is massive, and it told us a pretty stark story in relation to both Gaelic and a different, more nuanced, I think, story in relation to Scots. But we should now, at this point, getting, as we are on a month-by-month basis right now, the data from the most recent census, we should already be looking ahead as to what the most useful questions to be in the next census should be, and how we can tie the strategy in with that and use the census as a way to measure that kind of success. And I do want to highlight the reality that in many of our communities there is a hostility towards the public sector's efforts to increase the use of Gaelic. And I think that it's worth exploring that, because I think in many cases, certainly my experience locally, the hostility has not been an inherent hostility to the language. In some cases, it's been, in a lot of ways, about class dynamics in relation to Gaelic medium education schools, where the class makeup of the children who attend those schools and the class makeup of children who attend other schools nearby can be quite different. And therefore, we need to take a more nuanced approach to this that actually builds community support. But I do think ministerial accountability for the national picture and progress towards it is important. So we need to know what we're actually measuring against. And to that effect, I think another subsequent amendment that might be useful would be to require that reports are produced on this annually. There is a reporting requirement, but it's not clear that the reports would have to be produced annually. And I should emphasise that's annual reports rather than annual targets. There's a number of other amendments that I'll go through in closing, but again, I just want to emphasise that point that we shouldn't be passing legislation simply because Parliament felt the need for legislation. There is a clear desire to do something genuinely transformational here. That word was used a lot in Stage 1 evidence. The bill in front of us doesn't do that. I think there's a clear parliamentary majority in favour of it, though, and we are capable of bringing forward amendments to make this bill that meaningful transformational change that both the Gaelic community and the Scots language community are crying out for.
Thank you, Mr. Greer. We now move to the open debate. I call first George Adam to be followed by Tim Eagle, around 6 minutes. Mr. Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, it's quite interesting when you look at this debate, where I came to the Education Committee towards the end of the evidence that had already been taken, read through some of the evidence that was taken and seen the report, was there, for want of a better word, the read-through of the actual report itself. And when I hear some of the opposition members, to use some local vernacular, my heat is absolutely melting with the negativity that is coming from the opposition members. Ross Greer brought up an important point, which was the fact that the Scots language for the first time will have legal status. And I come from a generation who was quite clearly told by parents not to speak in any form of Scots, told by teachers to constantly not speak in any kind of form of Scots whatsoever. But that was our language, and that's a live language. And to me, a language is, you know, English spoken in certain parts of England is entirely different from what English is in the northeast of England. It's the same with any language in general, but there is a basis there for the language itself. I have felt some of the frustrations that my committee members felt with the report itself, and I was looking at some of the legislation we've had in the area. I remember the Education Scotland Act 2016 as I believe I was a member of that incarnation of the Education Committee. I'm a bit like Al Pacino in Godfather 3. I keep trying to get out of the Education Committee. They keep dragging me back in again. But it was the Gaelic Language Act of 2005 was before my time. So I suppose the bill is more about what is and isn't working for both of these acts, and what we got right and inevitably what didn't work. There's been steady progress made since the legislation was passed, but now is the time to look at both of Scotland's languages. And some may argue, yes, I will.
Liam Kerr.
Very grateful. I just wonder, because he makes a very good point, the member, about what didn't work from the 2005 Act. Can he point me to any report or any evidence taken by the government that shows where it's fallen short and shows what needs to be done to remedy it?
George Adam.
I think it's pretty obvious from the government what we have to do to move forward with both languages, and that's the point of this actual bill in itself. But the important part here is some may argue, what is the point of doing a bill like this in these very difficult times that we live in? And that's a valid argument. But equally, I would say our languages and how we communicate is a key factor to who we are as Scots. Presiding Officer, I'm always one who's looking forward, and we can do what we can do and what we can become. However, I believe we need to know who we are in order to go forward, and I believe that our languages are an important part of that. You may ask, what's Gaelic got to do with a post-industrial town like Paisley? Quite a lot, actually, because, like our Ouija neighbours, our name is taken from the Gaelic form. And being an ancient town means that we have in the past many Gaelic traditions. Of course, our town has embraced this and have now held the Royal National Mod on two occasions. Once again, embracing our Gaelic heritage to listen to everything modern Gaeldom, and I hope that's a word, has to offer. 8,410 visitors came to Paisley for the last Royal National Mod, 12% increase from the previous year in Perth, and it brought £1.7 million of revenue to Paisley Town Centre and generated 390,000 potential future visitor spend. So perhaps, Presiding Officer, our languages are part of the solution to the many challenges we face. Yes, I will.
Stephen Kerr.
I'm grateful to George Adam giving way. He's giving a stout account for his constituency's place in Gaeldom. But what is the one thing in this bill that's going to move the dial for Gaelic? What's the one thing in this bill? Because the member is talking enthusiastically about the bill. What is it in this bill, one thing, that's going to move the dial in favour of Gaelic?
George Adam, give you the time back for the
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The important part is we're actually talking about it. Gaeldom is here in the centre of the Scottish Government and the Parliament, and we're also talking about Scots in the legal sense, the fact that Scots will be legally part of Scotland's languages. That's surely an important thing for us all to look at this point. But continuing with the positivity, Presiding Officer, I have some frustrations, and some of these frustrations will be in my own mother tongue of Scots. Language is fluid, thing that is alive and continually grows, and I think Liam Kerr mentioned today this might be how we differ in this whole idea, because during the evidence sessions committee, colleagues said there was a problem with the Scots language and what the definition of that is. And it is it the colourful language of the west of Scotland, the Doric of the north east, or the more academic proper Scots of literature? And I've spent most of my childhood, as I've said, saying that I actually was told not to speak in Scots at any stage. My mother also warned me about the demon drink, and that didn't work out well for her either. But in the whole, this is a very long way of me saying it. In my opinion, it's all Scots. That includes DC Thompson's, the Bruins and Oor Willie, because it's an important part of our culture and how we move forward. And I want to hear my voice, the voice of my community within art and drama. The Deputy First Minister and I attended a cultural event recently, and she joked about more Paisley and drama. Well, there's quite a lot of drama in Paisley. I'd be quite happy to have more drama based in the great town of Paisley. But all I want is for all of us to get over ourselves a bit and embrace the many variations of our vibrant and extremely expressive Scots language. I'm pleased to see that the Scottish Government has a Scots language policy. It is also pleasing to see that the Scots features prominently in education, publishing and the arts. But I still say we need to work to ensure that all our voices are heard. I appreciate this bill will be the first time we give Scots the legal status, but our language we need to ensure remains alive and vibrant and an important part of our nation. In closing, Presiding Officer, I welcome this bill and how it treats Scotland's languages. It is important that we embrace our past while looking to the future. If we do, then if we don't do this, what is the point of all of us here? What is the point? Who are we as a people? Never again do I want any man, woman or child to feel embarrassed by their use of language or the language they use. We're better than that, and who wouldn't want to describe themselves in the colourful language of Scotland?
Thank you, Mr Adam. I now call Tim Eagle to be followed by Emma Roddick. Around 6 minutes, Mr Eagle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I just commend the Deputy First Minister on opening in Gaelic, actually? I think that's really important when we're speaking about these languages, that we actually speak it, those that can speak it in here. And I've always been a advocate for foreign languages in our schools as well. In advance of my thoughts, though, I'm keen to reflect on the fact that my predecessor, Donald Cameron, would have loved to have been in this debate. He no doubt would have responded in Gaelic as well. He would have loved to have scrutinised the bill, and he would have enthusiastically participated in its progress through Parliament. Donald would have relished the opportunity to highlight his personal passion for Gaelic, given it is the language of his forefathers, and that to this day he remains committed to its survival and its growth. What? Absolutely.
Deputy First Minister.
Put on any excuse to put on record my appreciation to Donald Cameron, and one of the things that we always sought to do was to work together to ensure that Gaelic didn't become overly politicised by any political party, and hopefully he can continue in that great mission of championing Gaelic on a cross-party basis.
Tim Eagle.
Sure, he absolutely will, because I know from my office staff that he really did feel this was an important bill to come forward. Whilst I don't have the same shared history as Donald with the Gaelic language, I share his belief that it should be preserved and promoted, not just because of its national importance as one of Scotland's Indigenous languages, but also because of its importance within its vernacular communities, almost all of which I represent. As my colleague Liam Kerr said in his opening remarks, the Scottish Conservatives cautiously welcome this bill, though we share many of the concerns outlined by witnesses during the Education, Children and Young People's Committee evidence sessions earlier in the year. The main consideration being that with respect to the Gaelic language, the concern is that the bill as it stands tinkers around the edges and therefore risks failing to address all of the issues that prevent Gaelic from thriving. During the committee evidence, Professor O'Gilligan of the University of the Highlands and Islands stated that it is a rebureaucratisation of the existing setup, and as the crisis emerged under the existing setup, the only way out of the crisis is radical change, and the bill does not amount to radical change. He goes on to argue that it would be better to halt the process as it is and redraft the bill with a view towards addressing the social issues rather than placing an emphasis on schools and the symbolic value of Gaelic. While I would never go as far to advocate starting from scratch, I believe it should certainly give members food for thought going forward, and the fact that substantial amendments will be needed should Parliament pass the bill today at stage one. It was difficult to disagree, though, with much of the evidence the Professor put forward during his evidence sessions, especially that much more emphasis is needed on addressing the social factors that prevent the growth of the Gaelic language. This, of course, was a key recommendation in the Gaelic Crisis in the Vernacular Community report published in 2018, which the Professor was one of the lead authors behind. Others have already touched on the findings of the 2022 census, which showed an increase in the number of people who have some Gaelic skills. However, this is a far cry from what is needed to ensure its long-term future. During committee evidence, Professor MacLeod of Edinburgh University urged a note of caution about the census, and others have picked up on this today, prior to the release of its findings on languages, stating that the census is a very crude instrument. While the aforementioned headline figure might show some positive signs, the fact that the number of people who speak, read and write in Gaelic has only increased by just over 11,000 people in a decade, a third of whom live in Glasgow and Edinburgh, shows that the current policy is not delivering the kinds of results that are expected or needed, especially in the Gaelic heartlands. I want to turn to the role of the Gaelic Board, which has come under some scrutiny during the evidence session. The Scottish Government proposes that the Board will no longer have responsibility for producing the National Gaelic Plan, and it will no longer be responsible for providing statutory guidance on Gaelic education. Now, this was broadly welcomed by those giving evidence in committee, with the general view that such changes would mean that the National Gaelic Strategy going forward would receive more prominence, and that it would help ensure public institutions take their responsibilities on promoting Gaelic language more seriously. I also understand that these changes have been broadly accepted by the Board themselves, and that in return, the Board will receive new reporting powers. However, the fact that the responsibility for developing the National Strategy for Gaelic Language and the Gaelic Education Board will be removed from the Board begs the question as to its purpose going forward. We must ensure that we get this bill right, because it doesn't just have implications for the future of the Gaelic language, but also, importantly for me, for the communities where Gaelic remains a working language. Tackling rural depopulation is one of my personal driving missions as an MSP, and ensuring that we have a thriving Gaelic language in the vernacular communities is one of the several ways to halt the depopulation trend in those areas. That means government has to meet the people where they are at in those communities who have real and practical solutions to offer. But at present, they feel they don't have a voice during these debates. Deputy Presiding Officer, in drawing my remarks to a close, I believe that more work is needed on this bill to ensure it not only fits the challenges it seeks to address, but that it also seeks to receive wide support from the communities that it will most impact. On the Gaelic language in particular, this Parliament has talked a lot about strategies and planning, but advocates of the language really do want meaningful action. That is what we need to achieve going forward, and I look forward to playing my part in that.
Thank you, Mr Eagle. I now call Emma Roddick, who joins us remotely, to be followed by Rhoda Grant, around 6 minutes. Ms Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking the Deputy First Minister as well for meeting with me earlier this month to discuss some potential ways to improve the bill. Firstly, and I realise I am pushing at Doris Foscolich with the
Can
Deputy.
I just halt you there? There's something up with your microphone or the way that it's playing out in the chamber. It's coming out through the headphones. Okay, if you perhaps want to resume and we'll see if that's any better.
Okay, can you hear me now?
You're still coming through the headphones rather than the...
I've tried turning off interpretation in case it's that.
You're now coming through both. But better both than
Are
zero.
Are you happy with both?
That's much better. Ms Roddick, if you could start again, that'd be very helpful. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I want to thank the Deputy First Minister as well for meeting with me earlier this month to discuss some potential ways that the bill could be improved. I do realise that I'm pushing at Doris Foscolich with the Deputy First Minister, but I do believe there are opportunities that could be taken here to strengthen the bill work on Gaelic in particular. And we have discussed this already. There should be an obligation on local authorities to designate areas where there is a high proportion of Gaelic speakers, not just an expectation or an option open to them. I think we have to recognise, and I'm not looking at any particular local authority when I say this, and I also include the Scottish Government, these areas have not had the support that they need so far, so we can't allow that to continue by making designation optional. 20% of the population is a high bar as it stands, and I just can't imagine a reasonable excuse for not designating an area with so many Gaelic speakers as an area of linguistic significance. The mandate must also account for smaller areas than local authorities or even wards, because while the whole Highland Council area, where I live, is not at 20%. There are certainly places within the local authority that are. And I would expect Skye, or at least part of Skye, to be designated as significant, as well as islands within Argyll and Bute, even if Inverness or Oban are not. Similarly, a clarification and even expansion of which public bodies are required to produce and implement Gaelic language plans would, I'm sure, be welcomed by the community, particularly where those bodies operate in areas of linguistic significance. Gaelic should be normal and visible, especially in areas where there's already a significant population of speakers. It is not an unreasonable expectation to be able to access Gaelic services in a Gaelic-speaking area. This also requires clearer and enforced consequences for when public bodies do not fulfil their obligations. And I will keep speaking with the Deputy First Minister about what kinds of enforcement or incentives could be adopted. Secondly, I want to restate, as I did years back at the launch of the consultation for this bill, the need to continue to recognise BSL as one of Scotland's official languages. I do understand the intention of this bill and the reasoning for focusing on Scots and Gaelic. However, I will continue to engage with the Deputy First Minister on whether the recognition that BSL deserves could be ensured through the next stages. My resident Gael in the office, Rory Cormack, as well as providing translations for me and for constituents who want to correspond in Gaelic, which I always welcome, also provides a really helpful insight as somebody who, unlike me, is a fluent speaker. Now, I was not taught Gaelic growing up, nor was I encouraged to learn it. My mother, while not being against Gaelic, was very keen that I learn French when given the option, as she felt that it would open up more opportunities and be more useful to me. Now, I regret that, but I also know from Rory that having Gaelic growing up does not mean that you keep it. And he's reflected that despite learning Gaelic in secondary school, which he only left 4 years ago, he doesn't now have the same opportunities to practice. And he feels that his Gaelic skills are declining as a result, even in a role where Gaelic is encouraged by his boss. So while I always encourage any constituents who want to engage with my office in Gaelic to do so, if that is their preference, please also know that by doing so, you would be giving both Rory and I a very welcome opportunity to practice. Recognising the limits of Gaelic schooling as a solution is important, but so is supporting Gaelic schools. And I know from speaking with colleagues in the City of Edinburgh Council that waitlists there are incredible. The same is true in the Highlands and Islands. Communities should have the right to request a standalone Gaelic school where there's sufficient demand, Oban being a good but far from the only example. I was glad to hear the Deputy First Minister speak about Solma Rostick. I have already spoken with her officials about ensuring support for the school and what it offers, which is something that nowhere else does. It is known as the National Centre for Gaelic Language and Culture, but it may as well be called the Earth Centre for Gaelic Language and Culture. So I look forward to further conversations ahead of stage two about what role the Languages Bill could play in supporting Solmore to grow and keep providing what it does to learners and recognising the huge role that it plays. Its loss or a limit on its ambition would be a huge blow to the language, so I hope to continue conversations about what support it could receive from the Scottish Government, for example, in establishing itself as a small specialist institute and having its contribution acknowledged in law. I'll finish by saying that I have loved exploring the Gaelic language since taking up my role as a Highlands and Islands MSP, learning new words, opening meetings where I can, and picking up on syntax that I recognise from my own Highland words, turns of phrase. But I am gutted that I didn't learn Gaelic in school and that I'm not yet fluent. So I want to make sure that other Highlanders are actively encouraged to learn and find that joy in the language as early as possible. It certainly shouldn't be the case that any young person wishing to learn Gaelic cannot access Gaelic medium education. And if we are failing at that hurdle, we are falling far too early. Gaelic is a rich language, it's also a rich culture and an indispensable part of Scottish culture, but it is one that there is real threat of losing as things stand. So I look forward to voting for the Bill's general principles and to working with the Deputy First Minister on helping it go as far as it can to protect Gaelic.
Thank you, Ms Roddick, and apologies again for the audio issues at the start of your contribution. I now call Rhoda Grant to be followed by Emma Harper, around 6 minutes. Ms Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Language is a means of communication, a vehicle to socialise, to work, to live. But fewer and fewer people are using Gaelic to do that, and that's the real concern. Up until now, try as we might, we've failed to turn that tide, and therefore we have to do something different. Sadly, the bill doesn't deliver any change, and certainly it doesn't deliver the change that Gaelic communities need. We need to fight that on two fronts. Firstly, to protect the Gaelic-speaking communities, communities that use Gaelic daily. These communities themselves are in perpetual decline. These communities are largely ignored by government policy. People who speak Gaelic are not Gaelic activists, any more than those of us who speak English are English language activists. They communicate in Gaelic, but that's it. They don't question why, it's simply how they communicate. But yet, without them, Gaelic dies. The census has been hailed as encouraging, and the improved numbers of those that have Gaelic, there are improved numbers of those that have Gaelic skills. I would tick that box as a learner, yet I'm not delivering this speech in Gaelic. I couldn't. We need to measure fluent speakers and gauge success by increasing their numbers. If we count having Gaelic skills as success, we totally miss the point and fool ourselves into believing that past interventions have been successful. They haven't. Indeed, the increase in Gaelic skills could be down to Duolingo alone. We're losing Gaelic-speaking communities because of the economy, demographics, and societal issues. The communities where Gaelic is spoken are under threat. A lack of jobs, a lack of homes, a lack of services, the things that we need to make it possible to live there. Add to that ferries that do not run. All of that impacts on Gaelic. People are forced from their communities, and these Gaelic-speaking communities become diluted or fail to survive altogether. People move to communities where Gaelic is no longer spoken as a means of communication. Their linguistic skills weaken, their language is not passed on to future generations. The issue that causes depopulation are the same issues that undermine Gaelic. Neither can be addressed without addressed by bringing in new people. We need to tackle the societal problems that force people out. We need opportunities for young people to allow them to stay. They need homes, jobs, and a future. The upsurge in second homes and holiday homes also plays its part. It's basically an act of omission rather than an act of commission. The research, the Gaelic crisis in the vernacular community, shows the decline, but it also offers solutions. Gaelic development and sociolinguistic planning, whereas in Gaelic, government must act, creating the conditions and act against the threats that help those communities to survive. Second, we need to provide education, but have often offered education as the only solution rather than part of the solution. I read with interest at the weekend Rhoda Meek's piece in The National, where she highlights where some of the actions taken to preserve Gaelic actually have the opposite effect. She says Gaelic speakers should be able to see things in their own language without always allowing for people who are learning, or without always seeing English next to it. She explains that all Gaelic TV has subtitles burned into it, not simply the ability to switch them on and off. She goes on to make the point the teaching and learning of Gaelic should not always come at the expense of the existing speakers, and too often it does. And I agree with her. Yes.
John Mason.
Thank you, Member, for giving way. Does she think, on this point of seeing Gaelic, does she think that, say, road signs, there's more could be done with that? Because when I'm in Wales, I see many more road signs in Welsh than I do even in the north of Scotland.
Rhoda Grant.
I think road signs are to be welcomed, but they shouldn't, and quite often they are the only thing the Transport Scotland do for the promotion of Gaelic. Too often we ask government bodies to produce Gaelic plans that actually gather dust over the year, only to be renewed again. They have to do more. Providing things in Gaelic is fine, but it can't just stop there, because that is tokenistic at best, and it doesn't encourage people to speak and understand and communicate in the language. So I think we need to look at that very carefully to see how we build on those things which are to be welcomed, but in themselves actually don't really make the change that we need. Because we need to cater for speakers as well, and that's something that is missing from the bill. So the focus on education is missing that crucial element, the Gaelic speakers themselves. And turning to education, the bill doesn't provide the right to Gaelic education, and that's something Gaelic activists have asked for. Will I get some time?
If it's brief. Deputy First Minister.
It's an area that I'm also very exercised about, and we've been exploring it. One of the things she'll appreciate is that enshrining in law certain rights often bumps up against equality legislation for good reason. And the example that she's cited is one where we have to be quite careful and explore with the legal minds how we give effect to that without creating more problems.
Rhoda Grant, and if you could begin to conclude.
I think we need to give effect to that, because I know of Gaelic communities where in school pupils can't even access Gaelic as a language course rather than even access education in the medium of Gaelic. And that is surely wrong, because those Gaelic-speaking communities, surely the default position would be to provide education through the medium of Gaelic and provide English units for those who wanted it. And presiding officer, the Scottish Labour Party published our policy paper on Gaelic, and we're clear that we need to protect and build Gaelic-speaking communities, and that takes hard work delivering services, providing homes and jobs. And Arthur Cormack's Short Life Working Group drew many of the same conclusions. And prior to that, the very stark reality was published in the Gaelic crisis in the vernacular communities. But sadly, presiding officer, none of those findings are reflected in this bill, and it needs to change at stage two.
Thank you very much, Ms Grant. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury. Up to 6 minutes, Ms Harper.
Thank you, presiding officer. As co-convener of the Scots Language Cross-Party Group and as a long-standing proponent of the Scots language, I welcome that we now have stage one of the Scots Scottish Languages Bill. And from the outset of my remarks, I want to thank the Cabinet Secretary for her engagement meeting with myself and other members last week and for her commitment to continue to work cross-party to ensure that we get this bill right for all of Scotland's Scots and Gaelic speakers. I also thank the Open University in Scotland and all the members of the Scots Language Cross-Party Group for their engagement regarding the bill. And I welcome Dr. Sylvia Warnecki to the Chamber, to the gallery today. Thank you for being here. Just on Saturday, I attended the Scots Language Awards in Cumnock Toon Hall. The breadth of talent, dedication and commitment to the Scots in preparing, shaping and advancing Scots was absolutely clear. There is so much love for our Scots language. It was so evident in the performances and the words for the presenters at the awards on Saturday. Hands up for TRAD, and everyone involved deserves huge recognition for that. Today, Presiding Officer, though, I want to focus my comments on the areas I'd like to see this bill strengthen. One of the key policy objectives of this bill is to provide further support for the Scots language and to improve its status, profile and use in public life and in our diverse communities, with the many variants of Scots spoken in those communities. And we know a lot of work has already been done, and I think in terms of housing and transport, which was mentioned in evidence at the committee, and I think the Deputy First Minister mentioned this, you know, for housing, for example, when we're building our new houses, maybe the street names could be named Scots words or Gaelic words so that we can further enhance and just put the language out there right in everybody's face when they're driving into their new homes, for instance. One of the key policy objectives of this bill is to provide further support for the Scots language and to improve its status and profile, as I said, with all the variants. And the Scottish Government has consistently recognised that the Scots language is an important part of Scotland's heritage, culture and national identity. But it is fair to say that the recognition could go further. And one of the key discussion points, which is consistently brought up at the cross-party group and from those involved in the Scots community, is the need to tackle stigma and discrimination which faces Scots speakers. Indeed, Presiding Officer, I have experienced this myself. I know others have. When growing up, like many others, we would often be told to speak English, speak properly and stop speaking slang. And we're hearing that comments like this are still prevalent today. And again, to highlight the stigma and discrimination, last year when I invited prominent Scots author and broadcaster Billy Kay to present Time for Reflection here in Parliament in Scots, there was a huge backlash of negativity on social media. So I welcome the statement in section 26 of the bill that the Scots language will receive official status within Scotland. This is the first time that legislation has made a statement about the status of the Scots language. And with this in mind, I would welcome further discussions with the... Just in a wee second, I would welcome further discussions with the Cabinet Secretary on how we can push this provision further to tackle the discrimination and stigma which those speaking their native Scots tongue face. And I'll take Liam Kerr.
Liam Kerr.
Official status isn't defined in the bill. How would she define it?
Emma Harper.
So, in regards to referring to the definition or the defining what the Scots language is, that is something that I would like to explore in amendments at stage two. So I think, given the Scots language, the umbrella terms, we heard from evidence that Bruce Younson gave at committee that the umbrella term Scots does include the variants of Scotland, whether you're in Stranraer or whether you're in Stromness. So it is something that, as we move forward, I think we can look at what language in the bill could be further defined. It was part of the Time for Inclusive Education's submission to the evidence as well. So, Presiding Officer, Section 27... I'll just carry on a bit, thank you. Section 27 requires the Scottish Ministers to prepare a Scots language strategy. And this section sets out the required content of the Scots language strategy, consultation and publication requirements and timescales for its preparation, review and revision. The provisions in the bill to prepare a Scots strategy will add importance to these priorities and to the work being done by Scots bodies and other authorities to make progress with these priorities. Couple more points, presiding officer. In the bill, section 31 requires the Scottish Minister to promote and support Scots language education in schools. This means that education authorities must also promote and support Scots language education in the schools under its management. And there has been some fantastic examples of this in Dumfries and Galloway already, such as at Traquair Primary School in Dumfries. The Scottish Ministers must consult interested persons in preparing the guidance, and such persons could include, for example, the Scots Language Centre, which has been mentioned, Scots Hoose and Yaldi Books. This work will ensure that young people have exposure to Scots from an early age and should hopefully help to tackle some stigma surrounding the Scots language. I have one ask which was raised by the Open University as well, so, such as for Gaelic. This bill will also place a similar statutory duty on public bodies in relation to their use of Scots. So I would welcome further discussion with the Cabinet Secretary on this. It is right that we are now providing greater recognition of the Scots language in education. And as I made the point to the Cabinet Secretary, this bill is important in recognising history, heritage and culture in all of our communities as it relates to Scots. So I will be supporting this bill at stage one, and I look forward to working with the Cabinet Secretary as we move forward.
Thank you, Ms Harper. Just a gentle reminder to colleagues who are looking to make an intervention as well as requesting it. It would be helpful if you could press the appropriate button. I won't guarantee that your intervention is taken, but it certainly helps those joining online. With that, I call Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Up to 6 minutes, Mr Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Gaelic and Scots are part of the historical and cultural fabric of this country. Some form of Gaelic is estimated to have been spoken in Scotland since the 4th century. It is in our songs and places' names. Our national bird wrote in Scots. But these languages are not confined to history or culture. They are living, used daily across Scotland. But if they are to thrive, they must be supported. Gaelic, in particular, is in a warring state. A study from the University of the Highlands and Islands warned it could die as a living language within decades. While the number of people with some understanding of Gaelic rose in the last census, the number of people using the Western Isles, where it is used most, has fallen. The struggle of the Gaelic language, despite government initiatives over the years, is linked to many other issues which members have raised today. Job opportunities in Gaelic-speaking areas, the lack of suitable housing in rural and island communities means people who grew up speaking Gaelic have no choice but to leave. Much of those housing being older and less heat efficient, making the cost of living is higher. These issues all tie into wider depopulation being seen in rural Scotland. We have to get this right. So the current scope of the bill is disappointing. The bill is largely focuses on education, but the challenges faced by Gaelic and Scots are multifaceted. Of course, a bill cannot be everything at once, but we have to recognise these issues. The proposed creation of Scots and Gaelic strategies has been welcomed by stakeholders. However, we must work to ensure that ministers are able to create strategies which are genuinely consequential. Earlier this year, the First Minister himself said the Scottish Government published too many strategies and should focus on delivery. And currently, Gaelic and Scots strategies will not even be delivered until 2028. We cannot afford to waste time. Expanding access to education is undoubtedly important. Last week, my colleague Michael Mara and I met with Solmorostek, a Gaelic college based in Skye. We were told that many students receive part of their education in Gaelic, but lose out as they move on to another education providers who cannot give lessons in Gaelic. ensuring the provision of Gaelic education in primary and secondary school, as well as further education, is key to ensuring the language has a strong future. But education will mean little if young people cannot find a home or job in areas which speak their language.
Yeah. Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. I don't necessarily disagree with his remarks, but he talks about the need for more teachers in order to teach this. Where's he going to get the teachers from?
Faisal Chowdhury.
Well, I'll leave that for the Scottish Government to tell us where the teachers, because there is a shortage of teachers in every sector. The bill also contains provisions to give local authorities the power to designate areas of linguistic significances, while recognising the areas where Gaelic is spoken is welcome. The bill is light on the details of what this will entail. The financial memorandum of the bill states there will be no cost associated with this bill. Ministers are given powers to create standards and requirements for education authorities in relation to Gaelic. The responsibilities placed on local authorities should be clarified. We cannot have another bill which gives more responsibility to already struggling councils, but does not give them the resources to achieve them. To conclude, Presiding Officer, the Gaelic and Scots languages should not be left reserved for train signs and tourists. They are living languages and face threats from many different directions. This bill at present does not account for these threats. However, we cannot miss this opportunity to safeguard Scottish culture. I hope the Scottish Labour can work with other parties to amend this legislation to ensure it responds to the pressing challenges Gaelic and Scot faces. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. I now call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Bill Kidd. Up to 6 minutes, Mr. Kerr.
Well, at the outset, I should say that I will follow the lead of my colleague Liam Kerr, and I will be voting for this bill at stage one. But I think Faisal Chowdhury actually hits the nail on the head when he talks about the lack of any consequential strategies that come out of this government. And therein lies my number one concern about this bill. Because I do believe, despite efforts from SNP speakers to the contrary, that much of what we see in this bill is symbolic. George Adam couldn't name a single thing that pertains to the bill that was going to make any tangible difference in terms of what actually happens. And that really is what matters. So I will be completely upfront in saying I support the foundational principle of the bill, which is about securing the viability of Gaelic. And I would also say, in complimenting the Deputy First Minister, her comments to the committee that are featured in the report of the committee about the importance of Gaelic continuing to be spoken were eloquently put. I support the right and desire of Gaelic speakers to live their lives entirely using the Gaelic language if they want to. But when the Deputy First Minister says that she hopes this bill could achieve that, I think she's being overly optimistic, because I can't see how. So I want to thank my colleagues on the Education, Children and Young People Committee for the report on the bill. I think they get to the nub of many of the issues, and we should all take note of their concerns, not the least of which was the unwillingness of local authorities and public bodies, including the Society of Local Authority Chief Executives and Senior Managers, to actually come and give evidence to the committee. That does absolutely concern me, as it has concerned the members of the committee. Because given the duties that will be placed on these bodies by the bill, it would really have been advantageous to all of us as lawmakers to have heard evidence from them. So what will change if this bill becomes legislation? Well, I don't doubt the good intentions of the Deputy First Minister. I think she knows that I respect her enormously, or indeed the Scottish Government, in producing this bill, which reads, frankly, like any other framework bill that has come before this Parliament in this session, laying obligations on ministers, local authorities and public bodies which won't move the dial one bit. I'm looking for tangible deliverables. I can't see anything in this bill that comes remotely close to a tangible deliverable. I think we have a statute book that we are cramming with more and more framework bills which are nebulous. And we need to get much more specific. There is no need for us as a parliament to go on producing more and more legislation that adds to the statute book but lies unimplemented, because it's unimplementable. This bill places additional responsibilities, in particular on local authorities, at a time where there are huge pressures on public finances. And we heard Sue Webber for the committee describing the limitations of the financial memorandum. If this SNP government gives local authorities licence to increase council tax in the coming year by double-digit percentages, there'll still be a paucity of funding for councils to carry out even the most basic services. I don't think the Deputy First Minister wants a bill to support the Gaelic language to be yet another of those tick box exercises which her SNP government has become renowned for. Of course.
Deputy First Minister.
I can agree with the member. I don't want this. I think that this issue weighs heavily on my shoulders and indeed on the shoulders of everybody in this room. And I suppose it's just that open invitation again that I've made to his colleagues that in advance of stage two, the opportunity for amendment to ensure that it does have the confidence of every member.
Stephen Kerr.
And I appreciate not only what the Deputy First Minister says, but where she's coming from. And I think she will find colleagues across this chamber willing to work with her on that basis. Now, I want to say something about the Scots language. Frankly, I'm with Liam Kerr, because I don't believe there is a single Scots language. And I think that the committee report highlights time and time again that there are so many variants and dialects of Scots that to talk about a single Scots language does not reflect any of our real life experiences. The Scots language is fundamentally an oral tradition, and it's highly localised. So my wife comes from Ayr and I come from Angus, and we use Scots words and phrases for the same thing that are completely different. We've always enjoyed this aspect of our language. We celebrate it. Of course I will give way to Emma Harper.
My understanding is that Scots was the language of the Parliament in Scotland right up until the 16th century, and then they decided to do it as Latin. It's not an oral tradition. Would you not consider the history and the heritage of the evolution of the Scots language, Mr Kerr?
Stephen Kerr.
Emma Harper, we're not living in the 16th century. We're living in the 21st century, and I'm talking about the experience of the people that live in Scotland today, and the Scots language thrives because it is an oral tradition. It's part of the celebration of our Scottishness, and frankly, it's enjoyable because of that. And the fact that it's an oral tradition really does matter. Emma Harper shouting at me, she's welcome to interject again if she wishes to.
No, she's not, because we're running out of
time. I had a look at the Scots language version of the committee's report, and I don't think we're doing ourselves any favours by spending taxpayers' money in creating these documents, which I don't believe for 1 minute people are going to read other, frankly, than to mock. And I don't like that. You can get a pretty clear idea what someone is speaking about when you listen to them speak in their local variant of Scots. But writing it changes its nature, making it, to my mind, a bit laboured and bogus. Let's make sure that we're doing the right things to underpin the take-up of Gaelic and not turning people away from it by imposing it in places where it isn't even a tenth language. We shouldn't be plastering public buildings, signs and vehicles with Gaelic in areas where it was never traditionally spoken. This only creates irritation among the public about their taxes being pointlessly spent. I wish I could, but I can't.
No,
if we're going to take this bill further, I think we will, stages two and three need to properly refine the bill. If we can't properly define or measure desired outcomes, or be realistic about how it will be funded, we should go back to the drawing board.
Thank you. We now have no time in hand, so members will have to stick to their speaking allocations from now on. I call Bill Kidd to be followed by John Mason. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. As the Parliament celebrates its 25th anniversary, We look back to the many achievements over this past quarter of a century. Almost 20 years ago, back in 2005, when I and many others in here, I'm sure, were but youngsters, this Parliament passed the Gaelic Language Bill. Have a wee laugh to yourself, at least. Thank you. There were many contributions that day, not only in English, but in Gaelic too. However, you'll be glad to hear that I will not subject you to any rusty Gaelic today. Back in 2005, our then colleague Alec Neil welcomed the passing of the Gaelic Language Bill, saying that we can be proud of the fact that the Scottish Parliament has rectified decades, if not centuries, of neglect of a key part of Scotland's heritage. Now, today, I feel the same. Today, I welcome the introduction of the Scottish Languages Bill, which seeks to emphasise that Gaelic and Scots are a significant part of Scotland's culture and to ensure they thrive and grow. This bill is more than a legislative step, it's a cultural commitment, a recognition that Scotland's rich linguistic heritage deserves our full attention and support. Our nation's identity is woven not only through the land and its history, but also through its words, languages and voices. Today, we take a step toward preserving and celebrating those voices. For centuries, Scotland has been a multilingual country. Gaelic, Scots, English, not just methods of communication, but threads that bind us to our past, connect us to each other and give us a sense of belonging. They are the languages of our poetry, our stories, our communities and our traditions. With this bill, we now look to the future. We look to protect and nurture our rich heritage for future generations. This bill, at its heart, seeks to ensure that our Scottish languages are not left to wither away or be relegated to the margins of society. It seeks to make certain that Gaelic and Scots... Yes, thank you.
Liam Kerr.
Grateful. If it seeks to try and achieve that, does the member think it will?
Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much. I believe this is stage one of the bill, and it's a start towards actually advancing our cause, as I've mentioned, about bringing Scots and Gaelic back into everyday use. And therefore, yes, I do think that it will make that difference. It's the beginning, but it's an important beginning. It seeks to make certain that Gaelic and Scots get the recognition, support and promotion they deserve, not just in our rural areas or specific communities, but throughout Scotland as a whole. And by doing so, we acknowledge that our languages are not historical relics, but living, breathing parts of our modern culture. It's often said that to lose a language is to lose a part of ourselves. Each language offers a unique world view, a different way of understanding our relationship to the world and to one another. But it's not enough to simply recognise these languages. We must actively promote and support them. This bill outlines key measures to begin how we do that through increased funding for language education, greater representation in public life, and a commitment to ensuring that services from healthcare to local government are accessible in these languages. For Gaelic, we must ensure that the language is not just preserved in the classroom, but spoken in the community, in homes, in workplaces and in the media. And the establishment of a National Gaelic Language Plan as part of this bill is a vital step. It will ensure that future generations grow up not only hearing the language, but feeling empowered to speak it as part of their everyday lives. For Scots, we must continue to give it the respect it deserves as a legitimate language and not a dialect or informal form of English. Now, Scots has been the language of many of our greatest writers and thinkers, and it remains the language of many in our communities today. This bill will provide support for Scots in education, helping children learn and take pride in their native tongue, as well as ensuring that the language is represented in literature, media and public life. Presiding Officer, as we consider this bill today, let us not think of it merely as an administrative step. Let us think of it as a commitment to the future of Scotland, a future where our languages are spoken freely, our communities are connected through shared understanding, and our cultural diversity is celebrated, not diminished. I urge everyone to support the Scottish Languages Bill, to stand for a multilingual Scotland, and to protect the voices that have shaped and will continue to shape our national identity. Together, we can ensure that Scotland remains a land where all languages are spoken with pride and heard with respect. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kidd. And I now call John Mason. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. Mason.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the opportunity to speak today. I only joined the Education Committee during June, and so was involved in the wording of the final report, but not in hearing all the evidence prior to that. Now, I confess to not having any Gaelic and not being fluent in Scots. In fact, languages are not my strong point at all. I did get somewhere with Nepali during my 3 years in Nepal, and that was only because so few people spoke any English, which does tend to show that we can all learn languages if we need to, but for those of us who speak English, there appears to be very little need to learn other languages, even ones which are native to this country. However, I did want to speak today mainly to declare my support and enthusiasm for both Scots and Gaelic, and for any help we can give them. Whether we speak them or not, these languages are part of our national heritage, and the whole country would be poorer without them. On a positive note, there are some encouraging signs, including literal physical signs, compared to when I was younger. Just seeing more Gaelic around, for example, in railway stations, is helpful. Seeing Glasgow Sraigheanna Banrin at Glasgow Queen Street gets the Gaelic words into your mind. And the demand for Gaelic medium education in Glasgow and beyond is also clearly encouraging. I do commend Glasgow City Council for responding to parents' desires, which currently includes a new Gaelic medium primary school being developed in Carlton in my Glasgow Shettleston constituency. And personally, I was encouraged to be in the chamber a few months ago when Alistair Allen asked a question in Gaelic, and in response, Kate Forbes answered in the same language. We want to see more of that happening. When it comes to Scots, some of us might be comfortable using a few Scots words, even if we could not manage a whole speech. So I do commend Emma Harper for suggesting words we might use. My father was quite keen on using Scots words, and particularly I remember him coming home on a Friday evening and saying he was Wabbit. Currently, we have no local newspaper in the East End of Glasgow, so my surgery notices go into a magazine called The Hullet, which I'm sure everybody knows what that means. Mind you, when it comes to accents, I do sometimes struggle to understand Kevin Stewart and Jackie Dunbar when they get going, whatever language they might be using. Now, some people would say that Gaelic is a dying language, that it brings no benefit to Scotland and should be forgotten about. But let's remember how important our tourism sector is and the amount of money that it brings into our economy. In the summer, I went to Estonia, Latvia and Lithuania, and I wanted to see what words they used, amongst other things I was doing, and how they were different from each other, which words were similar to the three languages. And if they had all been using the same language, for example, Russian, it would not have been nearly so interesting. Similarly, in Wales and Ireland, it is great to see the local language, even if virtually everyone speaks English. One of my few Welsh words is araf, which means slow, just because it is painted all over the roads. Not just for me, I don't think. I do not even know the Gaelic for slow, as I have not seen it on our roads. So I have to say that having one or more national languages can be a real boost for tourism and other visitors to Scotland. The committee clearly made a number of recommendations in its report, and the Scottish Government has responded to these. Perhaps not surprisingly, I am focusing on the financial aspects. For example, in paragraphs 42 to 44, it was noted that stakeholders are looking for more, quote, tangible support. I assume that would include more money, but the government response does not really address that point. Similarly, in paragraphs 122 to 125, the committee notes that the bill does not provide funding for local authorities in relation to designating an area of linguistic significance. The government response says that several authorities, quote, are making their own funding decisions, and the government will, quote, continue to do what it can to support authority initiatives. I do take the point, and I think the committee does as well, that some current funding can perhaps be redirected. However, I think there also remains a concern that expanded duties are likely to require money from somewhere. In paragraphs 279 to 283, we ask about the standards and requirements and the associated costs. The response gives an annex with examples of standards for illustrative purposes, but unless I am missing it, there is no mention of the costs. The committee notes that a Scots language board is absent in contrast to the board that Gaelic has, and this could put extra costs on Scots organisations, which the government is potentially relying on. The government then says it will, quote, reflect on measures that could be considered. I'm not entirely sure what that means, but it does sound a bit vague. Finally, in paragraphs 487 to 491, dealing with the financial memorandum, the government's position that the financial memorandum is not a budget is technically correct. However, if the FM is meaningful, it is a pretty strong commitment that the budget for the relevant year will at least be what is in the FM. I'm not entirely comfortable with the phrase wholly new costs, which appears a number of times. I think the committee's concern and that of external organisations is that the bill might lead to increased costs, even if they are not wholly new. Therefore, if, say, a local authority was spending £500 on a particular issue at the present time and that goes up to £1,000, that £1,000 would not be wholly new costs, but it would be increased, partly old and partly new. I think I'm... Well, yes, maybe I'm very quick.
Just to give some background to the wholly new costs, it's the fact that the intention is that right now there is money being spent on Gaelic provision and these would not be wholly new, it would be in addition to this.
I do understand that point. I think we could maybe come up with some different wording because I think both government and the committee was using that. But anyway, I was new to it. I accept I was new to it. I didn't have all the history. So finally, in this section, the committee does accept that finances are very tight at present, but there is a concern that this bill will raise expectations that cannot be delivered on current budgets. Anyway, having said all of that, I do very much support the principle of this bill and I hope it will pass at stage one and there should be plenty of opportunity for amendments at stage two. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Mason. And we will now move to closing speeches. I call on Ross Grier to close on behalf of the Scottish Greens. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I said in opening that I hope this afternoon's debate will bring forward some of the questions that need resolved about the bill and potential solutions. And I think it's mostly done that and I've enjoyed the debate with just one exception. I think speakers made some very positive contributions. There are a couple of points that I'd like to address, though. I don't agree with Liam Kerr's position on Scots, but I do think he was right to raise the Law Society's submission on definitions. I would say, though, that we don't define what English is in law, and the definition of Gaelic in law, as of the 2005 Act, is Gaelic, as used in Scotland. So I don't see the reason why we would need to hold Scots to a completely different standard that we do our two other national languages. And it does grate a bit for me when some argue that the range of other social ills we face mean that we shouldn't be prioritising this. After centuries of decline, deliberate marginalisation and attempts at annihilation of both of these languages, when should we start prioritising this? When Gaelic is an existential threat, how much longer should we wait before we start prioritising this? This is absolutely the right time. The right time was 20 years ago, 200 years ago, but the second most appropriate time is most certainly now. Now, I have much more sympathy with Michael Mara's points about the financial memorandum, and I do think that connects to some of the evidence that we heard, that legislation isn't really what's needed here, or it's certainly not the major missing piece of the puzzle. We heard that community development and youth work, for example, are absolutely essential. But we can't ignore the financial picture. We know that significant amounts of additional investment are not going to be forthcoming anytime soon. And there are areas of the challenge that we can resolve through legislation. Now, the Cabinet Secretary reflected on the progress made over the last 40 years. I think she was absolutely right to do so. There's been lots of achievement. But 40 years on, Gaelic is under existential threat today. So it's hard to say that the last 40 years overall have been a success, and it's to the credit of so many people who've worked so hard that the situation is not much worse than it is, but we do need to see this as an existential crisis for the language. The community is looking for much more tangible support, and I understand that it's not always legally possible to act on some of these proposals, particularly around education, as the Cabinet Secretary mentioned in response to Rhoda Grant, but also around areas like housing. There's a tricky interaction with equality law here. But there are a couple of further amendments that I would like to detail, potential amendments that the Greens are considering bringing to the bill. And the first is subsection 22C, because I quite like what that adds. It adds a new section to the 2005 Act that outlines that the Board and its functions must, as is both appropriate and in the circumstances reasonably practical, seek to give effect to the principle that English and Gaelic languages should be treated with equal respect. That isn't repeated throughout the rest of the bill. And I'd like to see that mirrored in other relevant sections, particularly the section on the strategy, because I think the principle of equal respect is a really important one. And that section, I think, is particularly well drafted and could be replicated elsewhere. I'd also ask the government to consider strengthening the section on remedies, where there's a failure of a public body to implement the duties placed on it. If the government accepts the Board's conclusions that a public body has failed in those duties, it can direct remedial action or it can just lay a report before Parliament. But surely if the Scottish Government has already agreed that a public body has failed to meet the duties set out in law, it must direct that body to act. So I'm not sure why that's optional. I welcome section 13.2, that moves responsibility for provision of Gaelic education guidance from the Board to ministers. I hope that will raise the status of that guidance, because we're all well aware that there are real challenges with compliance with the guidance produced by the Board. And again, though, I think this section can be stronger. It gives the Scottish Government the option of providing that guidance, which by my reading means they have the option of not providing it. So I would like to replace may with shall there. I don't think that's onerous on the government. What it does is it safeguards against any future government losing focus on this. And on a similar theme, the Law Society point out that the bill includes no sanction for non-compliance, or indeed no provision for appeal for a public body that wants to challenge the board's conclusions. I think both of those need to be addressed, and I agree with Emma Roddick on the need to strengthen and clarify this section. There are both carrots and sticks that can be used in situations like this. Areas of linguistic significance feel like a good idea, but to what end? The committee's asked for greater clarity on this, and again, I think that can be strengthened by amendment, because there is a danger of it being a tick-box exercise, or of it being an imposition rather than a community-led process. Ruth Maguire very effectively made that point on a number of occasions throughout Stage 1 evidence gathering. I think the education sections of the bill have been pretty broadly welcomed. Emma Harper has cited some excellent examples of what's already happening in these kind of areas. But there's further clarity needed in the bill. Both the board and HMIE have asked for clarity on the relationship between this piece of work and the ongoing education reform programme, and particularly that bill in relation to inspections and, again, that question of enforcement. The Greens will support this bill, but we are worried that what's in front of us, as I said earlier, is the result of that logic that something must be done, so we've done something. But we do want to work with the government to go further, and we welcome the Cabinet Secretary's outreach on that. The word transformational was used a number of times in evidence gathering. It's been again used this afternoon, I think, in the Cabinet Secretary's opening remarks. No one believes that the bill currently in front of us will result in the kind of transformation that I think most, if not all of us, want to see. Now, a bill alone was never going to do that. But there are areas of this challenge that can only be solved through legislation, and we cannot wait another 20 years for another go. So I look forward to working on a cross-party basis to get this bill right.
Thank you, Mr Greer. And I now call on Pam Duncan-Glancy to close on behalf of Scottish Labour. Ms Duncan-Glancy is joining us remotely. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The needs of the Gaelic language and Gaelic communities have, of course, developed since Scottish Labour.
Ms Duncan-Glancy, could you please pause for a second, because we're having problems with the sound. Thank you. Just pause for a second. Okay. It seems that the sound is coming through the headphones, so could I ask all members... Oh, no, I'm getting advice that the broadcast unit would rather fix the problem per se. So sorry about this, Ms Duncan-Glancy. Just please be patient with us. We'll get there.
No problem.
Ms Duncan-Glancy, could you please just give us a test run of a few words and we'll see if that's now working.
I will do. Does this work now?
Perfect. Thank you. And I would invite you to start your remarks from the top. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And the needs of the Gaelic language and Gaelic communities have, of course, developed since Scottish Labour's Gaelic Language Act, which we're particularly proud of, in 2005. And we need legislation that reflects that change. And so whilst we will vote for this bill today, it is our belief, and as many others have agreed, that the bill before us today does not do enough to protect the future of Gaelic language or Gaelic communities. And its education focus means that the legislation is restricted in scope. And even in that, there are flaws in the bill, as many members have highlighted today, not least the assumption that all of this can be delivered within existing resource. A matter the committee raised, and Sue Webber, John Mason and others have also highlighted in their contributions today. And so indeed, as my colleague Rhoda Grant has set out, the bill somewhat misses the point. Presiding Officer, my colleague Michael Mara has mentioned the research by academics at the University of the Highlands and Islands published in 2020 already. The authors concluded that without changes to policy and intervention at community level, Gaelic will not survive beyond the next decade. Yesterday, one of the authors of that research said that the draft bill, and I quote, effectively denies the crisis, that it fails to acknowledge the evidence indicating that these communities are at the point of societal collapse, and that the bill offers simply more of the same rather than the much needed new departure to help sustain Gaelic as a community language. And whilst we believe that there is and must be a place for Gaelic medium education and that it must be supported, we also agree with the concerns raised that the survival of Gaelic as a living language cannot be pinned on a narrowly drawn piece of legislation. In being so, the bill offers few, if any, concrete steps to support Gaelic communities and is quite vague, including, as witnesses have told the committee, on definitions which lack sufficient clarity and in the absence of effective community voice within its clauses. So I hope the government will consider addressing these issues at stage two, and I note the Deputy First Minister's commitment to the convener of the committee today to engage on the bill as it progresses, because as I and others in the chamber have said and agree with Liam Kerr, that the bill does require surgery to get it to a place where it can be truly effective. The bill also lacks sufficient enforcement capacity, as we've just heard from Ross Grier, and there is an absence of sanction or appeal provisions. All of this, coupled with the government's own assertion that the bill doesn't need more resource as it is simply repurposing activity, gives credence to some of the concerns of those who think the bill lacks substance. Presiding Officer, whilst the bill does endeavour to deliver change in education, the provisions on this do also need more thought. Gaelic medium education is already struggling. In Glasgow, the region I represent, and where we're proud to have four primaries and the only secondary school in the world teaching through Gaelic medium, we need a new primary school, but there are limited funds to either build from scratch or refurb an existing property. There's also no additional resource for the cost of translating or providing learning resources, including those required by the SQA, such as textbooks in Gaelic. The responsibility for this falls on Gaelic medium schools, which is an additional time and cost on already overburdened and overworked teachers. On that matter, a member of the Parent Council in Glasgow contacted me today and put the issue perfectly. They said, "There are particular responsibilities put on leadership teams in Gaelic medium schools, which are necessary to allow our children to fully access the curriculum, for example, ensuring a language-rich immersion during their early years, which has to reach far beyond the classroom, and the need for staff to create resources from scratch, particularly to meet the needs of all children." They go on to say that they've made the case that this should be reflected in the staffing formula, but have been advised that any changes will need to take place at a Scotland-wide level, with that then reflected in the funding allocated locally. The Scottish Government's financial memorandum, of course, says that the main impact of the bill provisions is a shift in activity and a repurposing of resources. And so I hope the government will take seriously the concerns raised by these parents, and I'd welcome the Deputy First Minister's response to them and these issues in closing. Relatedly, I also think the government must take seriously the recommendation that it undertake a workforce planning exercise in this respect. And I'd remind the Cabinet Secretary that this Parliament voted for the government to publish such a comprehensive workforce plan for education. Finally, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government must also realise that Gaelic medium education does not exist in isolation, as many members across the Chamber have highlighted today. For Gaelic medium education to be effective, parents and carers must also be supported to learn and use Gaelic, as Emma Roddick has set out. But at present, many parents and families lack fluency and so are unable to help their children with homework in Gaelic. Again, it falls to the school to find that additionality. The reality is that the bill before us fails to recognise the current reality, fails to recognise the intrinsic connection between Gaelic medium education and the need to keep the use of the language alive in the wider community, and fails to take account of the resource needed for it to be successful. Supporting Gaelic communities and to save the Gaelic language, including through Gaelic medium education, will need broad-ranging change that this bill does not yet deliver. And so I hope the Scottish Government takes seriously the concerns myself, colleagues, the committee, the community and experts have raised, and make the necessary changes to the bill so that it can make the difference that's needed and retain Parliament's support. The Gaelic community cannot afford for us to miss this opportunity. So today, Scottish Labour will support the bill, but we will need much amendment to it for it truly to deliver the scale of change needed to protect our Gaelic communities. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Glancy, and thank you for your patience. I now call on Ros McCall to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I have the privilege of closing this afternoon's debate, Stage 1 of the Scottish Languages Bill, on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. And as ever, we welcome any opportunity to engage in debate about all of Scotland's languages and I welcome the constructive approach taken by members across the Chamber. I would like to reiterate that we are supportive of the bill at this stage, and we agree in principle that there should be additional focus and support for our traditional languages. Now, as I've said before, my Gaelic and Scots is very limited, as is my Doric, Orcadian and Lanlands, but having said that, I am a Conservative. Our whole ethos is based in tradition, that our customs and heritage play an important part in who we are, and our past informs our future, and not all that went before is bad. I believe in conserving things, particularly when it comes to the culture of which we all share. I'm going to note a couple of the interesting contributions from today. And I want to start by thanking the interpreter who helped me massively to follow the opening remarks from the Deputy First Minister. I think I'm similar to John Mason, as I am particularly linguistically challenged. The Deputy First Minister talks of reversing the tide when it comes to the uptake and continued use of our Scottish languages. But I think it's important to recognise we're pushing against a tsunami of social media that's all in English. I also note that the Deputy First Minister's agreement that the bill in itself is not a solution and that further work has to come at stage two with cross-party support, and we are happy on these benches to take up that offer. My colleague Sue Webber highlights that due to current funding restrictions, only 39% of Gaelic projects applied for received funding, and both Stephen Kerr commented that on the concerns of the financial memorandum of the bill, which is a very important point. Ross Grier mentioned that the need for the symbolic recognition of Scots, which is something I actually agree with, but it is important that Gaelic and Scots are different stages in the legislative process, and that has to be recognised. So Liam Kerr's question that what does the government actually want to achieve for both languages is an important issue, and perhaps the Deputy First Minister might wish to comment on that in her closing remarks. Presiding Officer, as I've mentioned in my remarks, I am for supporting our traditional languages. With Scots Gaelic descending from Eilish Gaelic in about 500 AD, Scots descending from Northern English with the earliest written records dating back to the 14th century, and we have different dialects within that. Orcadian is a dialect of Scots that's influenced by Old Norse. The term Lanlands was traditionally used to refer to Scots as a whole, but more recently interpretations suggest it refers to the dialects of Central and South Scotland. Mm-hmm. And Doric is a term that was also once used to refer to the Scots dialect in general, but is now only used to refer to mid-northern Scots dialect. We can certainly see the adaptations and morphosis of our language over the centuries, the challenges each language faced forcing change to the way we speak and where. It is these changes that in part brought the Scottish Government to recognise Scots as an Indigenous language of Scotland, and UNESCO considered it a vulnerable language. Gaelic in particular faces many challenges, and it was vital at the outset of this bill address these threats adequately. Now, these threats were mentioned by numbers of members today, and they'll not be unfamiliar to any who have read the official report on proceedings relating to Gaelic over the last 25 years. It was 6 years ago, back in 2018, when UHI published its report, The Gaelic Crisis and the Vernacular Community. Its findings were sobering and included that the social use of transmission of Gaelic was at the point of collapse. According to researchers, only 11,000 habitual speakers of Gaelic were left. There has been several initiatives to enhance Gaelic across Scotland, and these should be applauded, but the truth is they have failed to cement any sort of basis in young people across the Highlands and Islands and beyond. This bill must not repeat the mistakes of the past. It must not become just another piece of legislation. It has to have the required cut-through with both the Gaelic and Scots-speaking communities if it's going to make a difference. And it is here that I turn to the committee's Stage 1 report, which supported the general principles of the bill, which are to provide further support for Scotland's Indigenous languages, both Gaelic and Scots. And credit goes to the committee on this work, but I'd like to point a couple of their conclusions. The committee did not consider that on its own the bill will create the necessary conditions to address the challenges facing Gaelic language or provide the necessary support to protect both Gaelic and the languages and dialects that come under the term Scots. The committee believed that more needs to be done by the Scottish Government beyond. I will. Thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thank you very much, Ross McCall, for giving away. I've been thinking, as you said, that Scots comes from Northern English. My understanding is that Scots is a West Germanic language, so it's similar. It comes from the same family as English, Dutch, Flemish, Frisian and German. So I just want to make sure that I heard you correctly, because my understanding is that Scots is a West Germanic language.
Always through the chair, Ross McCall.
I thank Emma Harper for her intervention. I researched this, but I think this actually highlights the problem with trying to define Scots. It makes it a very difficult process, and I think you've actually highlighted that very well with your intervention. Yeah. The committee believes that more needs to be done by the Scottish Government beyond what's set out in the bill. The committee was also concerned by the lack of clarity within the bill, particularly in relation to what obligations and strategies, standards and guidance will be placed on public bodies and the associated cost of meeting such obligations, not least because the financial memorandum needs to be sufficient to fulfil the objectives for what I think there is consensus across the floor. I also note the concerns of the Law Society of Scotland that were mentioned by my colleague Liam Kerr in their briefing for this afternoon's debate, in which they query whether the definition of Scots language is used in Scotland is clear enough to take account of the regional variations within Scotland, and it is a legal requirement that we look at that. Not a requirement to look at that, sorry, there is a legal issues, and that's why we have to look at that. Deputy Presiding Officer, the committee expected the Scottish Government to come back with some clarity prior to stage two. We on these benches concur. Much has to be done. The bill must be more than a further promise of hope and change. We must look at the investment of further public funds in a quantitative and qualitative way and actively make a change to use and promote our Indigenous languages. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McCall. And I now call on Deputy First Minister Kate Forbes to close on behalf of the Scottish Government. Up to 8 minutes, please.
Moran Tang, Offagur, really. Had the heel Gaelic Riev, Gukoyershnoch, Farinjach, Achal. A Chomri, Strath Naran, a Chichin an Lochaber, Eregel, agus na Helenin. Chanurin gain a chor Coyershnochgen a chal. Shirin un amas a hakamse, lish a villisho. Agus mahashin a geari urtis a yanu, femishin biachachach grun chemenin. Chane, agus chaberriev, jirach un keisht, Nyo un uasgloch a haun nur a hike gug Gaelic is alabish. Hashin sulyr von Jespidshaw agus kuchich e von Arsenioch je gianish e uaris se co corlichach agus na jiffer chushin erin jach coyet aun an ashk ire a hoon. Hayet shin ulle kutrmach son an urtish a yemis sheen a yanu. Hoshich su Weber a breen me budget. Hole misha na horse the committee, eggs na dunye, a good shachet unye, gus fianish a horse, yan e realtis. Get a ha kuchem moor, a budget a king and draste. Hame a tuxin jeho kutrmuch saha munichuch, son a yalik, agus alabish. Ach, ik nu naam, na vjachsa, ha na prievachasin ik luchlaverst na Gaelic, eis na prievachasin ik luchlaverst na Bierle, uanerin in un rut. Tijdis, bunstructur, kodel. Agus bachor, bekendjen erigit a hasin a kosk bunstructur, marsin in draste, et al na satje, an in koersnoch in Gaelic. Mahashin son barach eiching aus na coirsnochgan Gaelic, na coirsnochgan tradition te. Chanea jirach mönichach ur aha a yi orn, agus hula sin sin vo John Mason, chanea jirach mönichach ur aha a yi orn, ach jianu kienchach gavel mönichach haunsa vajit an draste, jianu barach gus Gaelic niarstachach sna coirsnochgan tradition te. Vami kuchach guntachach le Liam Kerr agus duing ille. Gwyl feimaking e biachachach ddicho eifachach sa han himmerstenaking, na planichinaking, na loginaking, in bilisho. Han kunt sluie torst fikerschen gang, ha barach duing e klachige kanen, agus ha na harven geluch laverst e dol e suis. Ach, hunnig sin kuchach gwyl na harven geluch laverst ans de skiren e traditionte e dol shias. Agus an yellin kunta slui is shaltin jeho filinta sa haet. An yellin shaltin jeho filinta sa haa luch lavarsht, nyo jeho trich sa haet e brein e canan. Hami a biachgachach in na triplagin agus na dulin e huv en keisht ma e eifachgach. Hami kutsuch taingul son in taich hola mivo e michal mara agus duing e ila. Hwrst desyn gynro yn canon o'n neging, agos ffemi yn bila y fi eifoch goch. Biachach cwtioch yn asg y iolsych yn realtys yn economyn economicoch agos sosialta yr son y galeg. Agos yn y nŵfyr ha mi uafsoch taichol rhi ofygyrn lesach hi y galeg. Ystawrwg fa mi awn y celiafyrra awn sy'n ialain sgianoch ffara fel eili rancyn ŵn jyn y ofygyrn lesach hi galeg yn sy'n. Es nu de chaimi, si es gan talle, amsevalle, chole mi tor galic ri brein. Van koersnach gynne, es syri chiele, le brochtis keike, dunje ook, dunje na sinne, agus va galic ri chleinsin. Chur eili in lunchin doi, gus galic a chumel bio, aatje, Far wel dunje, ik wel galik, het chien michele, is een brein galik. Geentje nog, was scholieren aan kutjoch, scholieren voor een palle pjarst. Agus fa iets yn ansyn ylain sgionoch, yw'r son siachgain. Siachgain efi e gywnsoch y galeg, agus efi e gianw Jeffa Rwtyn, lysyn teacher galeg achga. Chanyl môr an scholar yn galeg an yn piarst, an academy piarst, agus fa yn unig ora galeg chlynsyn ansyn coersnoch, sy'n arsynioch. Agus ysyn sy'n sialtyn, jeich o cwtrymwch sy'n hae, gyfelwch fygyrn lesach hi agin, agus cwtioch shouting, mar a hel coersnach gan tradition te awn, chafi galic bio. Mar a hwrs mi ec yn tosioch, had o chil galic riaf gyd coersnach far yn diach chal. Agus mae hasyn son galic y cwmol bio, hasyn o chil chwch gyfel sy'n gyfel na coersnach yn mar cilio fore ffeimoch i'r barach taich. Hwrst Ros Grier cwtioch gynro unifau yn can yn cwtrymoch, agos eisiau yn ffyr, gan Chikif sy'n bu. Sŵr yn gein oper y ianw amser fila, mae'r hasyn y ffiach yn rhi ianw, agos ac yn nŵr nawm, y gwper tro ymwrstyn ila. Y lorach barach mewnychwch, mae eisiau yi o'n. Agos ysdeichwch stiwrwg sylir i'r son byn yn poblwch. Hanyd tyg y hawn, ha chwle cael cwtrymoch, Se ŵndyn y prifach sy'n ac yng Ngwyla, gyfel sy'n effeithgyn ertys i'r na harafen, i'r na coersnochgyn, agos cwtioch, i'r yn ira dje ilyntys. Of ag rili, le cwochgyn y fila sio, syrin i'r bwonochgyn brifwr y gleuch i'r son sgolchyn is iwntychwch, yn economi is bwntstructur, na mienyn immersion coersnoch agos iwntychwch do innafich. Mas criach nich mi, bywalwm mwth chaing y tors ian chymiti i'r son yn biach gen minidioch is taichgyl achga. Cwtioch, hwyr sy'n tor taich fan y dwnia y gaf parst awn yn cwchorlichach realtas na holopa agos a chwg ffyn y siachyd ian chymiti. Yes.
The Deputy First Minister for taking the intervention. I was wondering if you might be able to comment, or sorry, the Minister may be able to comment on Faisal Chowdhury's comments regarding Gaelic medium education teachers and how we might be addressing those and that challenge we have.
Deputy First Minister.
I should know if it's a good thing, because for me, a brain you could check in and you, Hain. Agus fa gish clown eke, inish a doll tro vi tron ohai e vi na teacher in Gaelic. So hashin feimoch i'r barach teacher in Gaelic, ham is mwynchyn gyfel doi yn awn yn dras dy hein i'r son barach teacher in Alorac, a ham i'r tygsyn se rydyg yn uafsoch cwtrymoch, agos mae ha barach parent yn egiri ffilm trwy yn y Gaelic i'r son yn clawnach gy, hashin y cilwch o gyfel sy'n feimoch i'r barach teacher in, ham i'r tygsyn sy'n gynchicaf sy'n bi. Se ymwch tŵrys ron sio, chynnycys taich har ffarty sy'n ffarlymyd sio, gan Gaelic agos alabys. Agos fa gerafwch ac yng yr taich sy'n yr eisht yn jw, agos ham i cyn sy'ch gyfel sy'n ŵla yr son yn len yn taich sy'n, agos ham i gyma taingl yr son yn taich sy'n fo'n y party yn yr ffat. Mae eirwch, ha iachtri sialt yn gyng, nach jach spes yn nochgwch yn Gaelic is alabys sy'n awm y ielwf mae'r bychor. Ach bychor at y fi awm iaif awn yn alapa agos awms y ffarlymyd sio. Agos awn yn yr ryngau y ha e gian of cynsioch gyn ceid anio is taich y chors gan da chanan agos gyn ceid yn cwr i'r yrst. Er yn ywyr sy'n, ba malwm mwchaich y chwyr agos moloch don y beil taich y chwyr, rysio glwysyd, gyn cwr y ffarlymyd yntyr i principal yn ffarsyn bilyn yn can yn alabynach agos môr yn tain of y gyrdeoli.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. That concludes the debate on Scottish Languages Bill at Stage 1. And there will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change position. Thank you.